አንተ እግዚአብሔር ወይ ለካይናት ለካነ ሚስተር ወይና ዲያቆናት and those of you our brothers and sisters who were purchased by the precious blood of Christ may God grant you all longevity to live long and to live well ረጅም እድሜና ጤና ይስጥልን አሜን so before I go into the subject of today which is lemon tawahido or why the orthodox tawahido church as it's also known the alexandrian rite or the gez rite as it's been found historically in Ethiopia and Eritrea, I want to give you a very brief overview. So first and foremost, from the misbah, or the psalm that was chanted earlier today by our brothers, the deacons, we learned that blessed are those who come in the name of the Lord. Other translations of the scriptures say happy are those who come in the name of the Lord. So blessed be all of you, and desibelanchu. Rejoice, be happy. The second thing that we heard, which is the main subject to tie into the subject or the theme or the motif of this whole weekend, is that Peter was a rock or a stone, a foundation upon which the gates of Hades or the gates of Sheol or the gates of the place of the dead, the forces of darkness and dread, could never win or could never conquer the church. And that church is what we'll be talking about today. In the beginning, I'll give you an overview about how you can find hope in the church and how one of the main functions of the church is to find hope. Then, because that's going to be very broad and zoomed out, we're going to zoom in a little bit more to our communion writ large. So not just Ethiopia and Eritrea, but all of our sister churches that make our communion and what makes us so special, so unique. What is it to be found there? And there's an impolite truth to be told there about our communion, but we're going to boldly talk about that as well. Finally, us being children of Aksum, where from which our Gezrite tradition sprouted from, I'm gonna cover that a little bit and talk about what each and every single one of us have a duty to do, which fundamentally is to share. But in order to share, just like when you're on an airplane, when you're ready to give air to someone else, first you have to be able to give air to yourself. So in order to share, you need to go learn for yourself. So I'm going to describe to you how vast are the depths of the ocean, which are the wisdom that are found in the Gezrite tradition, which is our tradition from Aksum. So let's start with the beginning. In the beginning, whenever we talk about Christianity, we have to say, what exactly is Christianity? Now, a lot of times, maybe especially so in Texas, less so in Cali, where I'm from, you have the name of the Lord everywhere. In Hollywood, you don't hear it as much, or if you do, it's not for good reasons. So maybe you hear the name of the Lord more often here, and you may think Christianity is an assumed thing here, especially in the United States. But we should never assume people know what Christianity is, because there are a lot of false teachers prancing around talking about Christianity. So we have to make very sure to know first, what is this thing called Christianity, and who are all of those people and all of those denominations and factions and groups that refer to themselves as Christians? There are many different definitions people have, but the simplest definition, if you take nothing away else from today, is it's part of the title of even Athanasius the Great, a Greek bishop from which our own hierarchy started, was called contra mundo or sara adam, against the world. So Christianity as defined in negative terms is that which is against the world. In positive terms, we're going to talk about it for the rest of today, but in negative terms, Christianity is in contradistinction with, it is differentiated from the world. You have Christana and you have Adam, and these things should be very different. Si wahadu, or when they become tawahado, that's not a good thing. So we need to make sure they're separate. The next thing I could say broadly is that very broadly speaking, and maybe we can get into this more in our Q&A section, which will be more interactive, but I just like, we're just going to touch it a little bit. There are two main groups that call themselves Orthodox, and both of them refer to themselves as Christians. Then we have the Catholics, which include the Roman Catholics, and then everyone who they've included underneath them and underneath their Pope. And then we have what we saw in the advertising for this way or for this gathering, that there are the Protestants, who often no longer even use that term to describe themselves, and may try to trick you by using other words like non-denominational or evangelical, or some of them will just say, that person's Catholic and I'm Christian, and try to make it seem super neutral. But they have tens of thousands of denominations. I've never seen an exact number, but sometimes I hear it as high as 40,000, and sometimes I hear as low as 10,000 or 20,000. The important thing is it's a lot of splintering, a lot of fracturing, and based off of what I'm going to tell you today, it's not something that we want. Now, all those people at least claim to be Christians, so they're at least tentatively on one side of that eternal battle until the Lord comes again to judge the living and the dead. On the other side, we have the forces of the world. And don't worry if you don't catch all of these names, but you may have heard them before. And again, I just want to touch on it now. We can go in depth later. I'd say the three biggest forces of the world, and there are many forces that could be described, especially if you've ever seen Abba Thomas Finley at our church. He always talks about his favorite enemy to talk about is secular humanism. There's also postmodernism and nihilism. These are giant philosophies that some of you are littler and may not know. Others of you that are older and larger may have at least heard the name if you don't know what it means. Secular humanism are the people who try to have morals and ethics, that which is right and that which is wrong, but without religion. They think that you can move on and everything could be hunky-dory without any religious practice. Those are some of the scariest people because they will try to resemble the language of the church as much as possible. Some of the other forces of the world or enemies of the church that the church is differentiated from, they don't even attempt to say what is right and wrong. And you can tell through their music, you can tell through their attitudes, and some of the language that they use. And that means more like postmodernism. So the postmodernists, they have many different names. Sometimes they're called relativists. You might not know the term, but you may know someone who says, this is your truth, and this is my truth, and then so-and-so, galit na galit, everyone has their own truth, but there is no truth. Those are the postmodern folks, the people who talk to you about vibes and energies and the universe and all sorts of nonsense on stilts. Then you have the final stage, probably the darkest, but at least the most consistent aspect of the world, promoted most prominently by the German philosopher Nietzsche, which is nihilism, which means meaninglessness. And those are the people who look at the universe, all of the creation of the heavens and the earth that the Lord has made, and they say there is no meaning to be found there. Now, interestingly enough, in my opinion, at least as I've examined Christianity and the world, I believe that inevitably, from Protestantism to nihilism is where people will go. You begin there, and because they try to be anti-tradition, because there's an issue of succeeding or not being able to pass along through hand-me-down the next traditions, they eventually become secular humanists. Most of the secular humanists are working in politics today, where they view their politics as their form of religion. That's where they get their spiritual release. And then honestly, if you see like what their kids are, or even what some of them eventually become, they eventually abandon the truth, and then they get to this point where they think life is meaningless. So again, all these groups we can talk about later. The big picture to understand is that Christianity ultimately offers hope, and the world can only ever offer you randomness and arbitrariness, which is hopelessness, or despondency, which is deep. It's like depression, a deep depression or a deep sadness, because you're not able to have a meaning-making mechanism. You don't look at things and say there's a greater reason for this. There is our shepherd and our lamb who sits on the throne, who is in charge and in control. He is the one who has everything in the palm of his hands, all of space and all of time. So just remember, fundamentally, Christianity is defined as against the world negatively, and positively, it is that beacon of hope, that light of hope in the world that is always sticking hope in. So that was super zoomed out. Now when we zoom in, we have our name, Tawahedo, and from Tawahedo, you know, it's referring to Christology, which is a very deep theological matter, which would be too rigorous to go through right now. But if you've ever heard the term, positively, we refer to ourselves as the Miaphysite Communion. Sometimes people call us the Orientals versus the Eastern. I personally don't like that because they're defining us from their point of view in the West, from their own racist maps when the globe is spinning around and there is no up, there is no down. They're saying those people over there in the East, Oriental means East, Eastern means East, and they're defining us towards and in relation to the West. So I don't like that. A lot of people call us non-Chalcedonians, referring to the council where a lot of these controversies were hashed out early on in Christianity through the bishops, and where we ultimately parted ways with Rome and with Byzantium, which is the Greeks or the Eastern Roman Empire. And so actually I have a couple friends from Seattle who are fellow laborers in the gospel with my good friend Deacon Frazier, and he actually uses a term that I will borrow today. He calls us pre-Chalcedonian rather than non-Chalcedonian, meaning whatever Beit HaChristian was or whatever the church was before that particular theological controversy. But I'll make it even simpler than all of that. So the impolite truth that I was going to tell you about our communion is if you ask Lemon Tawahedo, or why the Orthodox Tawahedo communion, which is, of course, Ethiopia, Eritrea, Syria, Egypt, and India, and Armenia, if you ask why, it's because that is what Christianity is. Now, sometimes we may extend an olive branch, we may be more merciful, and maybe try to collaborate on certain things. Some of us gathered today earlier, we're talking about how sometimes in the Middle East, especially with other people who call themselves Orthodox, sometimes they'll make some exceptions that the whole church won't make because they're surrounded by so many people who are just against Christianity in general. However, what we are, what our communion is the historical Christian church. The historical Christian church, that rock or that stone, that Petros or that Peter, that was invulnerable to, indomitable to the gates of Hades or the gates of Sheol, the forces of darkness and death, began in Antioch, which is Syria, and Alexandria, which is Egypt. Antioquia wa Iskandria. If you see, even in the Holy Scriptures, no one denies that Antioch or Antioquia was the very first place where people were called Christians. And they were called Christians to try to mock us. They said, you're followers of that Christ who was put to death. What they didn't realize is that ultimately we would flip their own ideology upon their head, make it topsy-turvy and flip the tables on them, because the power of Christ is reigning and their mockery has fallen silent over centuries and centuries and really millennia at this point. So the impolite truth is that Christianity began in Antioch and in Alexandria. That's where the thrones or the seats or the manabit of Peter and Paul and Mark were. That's where they were, and they planted bishops to replace them, who put in place priests, who put in place deacons, who until this very day, we are still standing in that proud tradition. And in that proud tradition, like I said, since Chalcedon, which happened in 451 AD, a very long time ago, nearly 1600 years ago, if you look at what happened to the Byzantines or the Greeks, They split with the Catholics, who then split with the Protestants, who then split infinitesimally. They're still splitting to this day. If you looked at each and every single one of them who were there and left us, they all fractured. They all scattered. Whereas if you look at our communion, it's had hibrat. It's had table fellowship or fellowship. It's had communion and sharing and participation. And although we've had some theological controversies over the years, we've never, as a full communion, split since 451 AD. And I think if you remember that the Lord said, you will tell a tree by its fruit. If you look at the fruit produced by a communion that has stayed together, that has stayed in Hibrat for that long, I think it paints a very beautiful message. It's at this point where I'll read a few scriptures for you to back it up, to make sure you say, Henokin dazi adam. I don't want that to happen. It's Yigzavier Khan. So first we have Proverbs chapter 6. So Proverbs chapter 6, to show you how much the Lord loves hibrat, or the Lord loves table fellowship, or communion, or sharing with one another. There are 6 things which the Lord hates, 7 which are an abomination to him: haughty eyes, a lying tongue, and hands that shed innocent blood, a heart that devises wicked plans, feet that make haste to run to evil, a false witness who breathes out lies, and a man who sows discord among brothers. Or a person who sows discord amongst brothers. If any of you don't know what discord is, that is the scattering of people. So people who split apart churches are things not just that Yigzavier Aywaddim, or the Lord, doesn't like. It says, Nafsu at bekayim tisayif. What his soul or his breath of life, abominates is the English. I don't know if you've ever used abominate in a sentence, if you've ever felt that strongly about anything, that you would abominate it. But he abominates the sowing of discord amongst brothers and sisters. So that's how powerful it is. Again, in Psalms 133, according to the Hebrew text, and 132, according to the Greek text, we find a very famous passage which the fathers of our church sing so often and beautifully. One of my favorite mazmur, Nahu sanai wa nahu adam soga yehelu ahau habura. Behold how pleasant and good it is when brothers sit together in unity, or in fellowship, or in communion, or in sharing. It continues in a very beautiful literary language. It's a short psalm, so I'll finish it. It is like the precious oil upon the head, running down upon the beard of Aaron or Aaron, running down on the collar of his robes. It is like the dew of Hermon, which falls on the mountains of Sion. For there the Lord has commanded the blessing, life forevermore. Finally, we have in Ankaza Biswan, or in the Sermon on the Mount, as it's known in English traditions, in Matthew chapter 5, the Lord says, blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the sons of God. Or if you'd like, happy are those who reconcile, who resolve their disputes, who manage their conflict, who squash their beef, for they are called the heirs of God. So if you realize in Proverbs, in Psalms, in the Gospel, anywhere you go, the Lord, one of his top priorities, above anything else you may think, one of his top priorities is keeping the people together. That's why I'm just so happy. You know, I was here 3 years ago before the Ethiopian Synodos got back together. But now I'm here after it. It's been 2 years where we've been celebrating that peace. And every day, you know, no matter what else havoc is going on, I'm just so thankful at what we're able to do. It's great when we're all able to gather like this from all over the United States. But what I found recently since our reconciliation is how much wisdom we have in our own areas. I've seen through the celebration of Timkat and Maskat and other things like that, that we're able to use each other in ways that we weren't able to do to spread the glory of God more. So remember, Christianity against the world, Christianity as hope versus hopelessness or despondency, and remember our Tawahid al-Communion as the historical church that was founded in Antioch and Alexandria that we have direct ties to and that has focused on unity, participation, communion, sharing, table fellowship, ibadah, all of it from the very beginning. Finally, we jump to Aksum, where we meet a Greco-Syrian named Frey Menatos, who's later called Abba Salama or Kasate Berhan, the revealer of light. Because although there are accounts, like in the book of Acts, that Christianity reached Ethiopia in the first century, it wasn't until the 300s that we actually got the lineage from Mark and Paul and Peter to put us in the proper historic church with our bishops, with our patriarch, with our priests, and with our deacons. And from Frey Menatos, we have an environment in which when they were persecuted, Tasa'atu Qaddusan, or the nine holy, also Greco-Syrian saints, could come and help spread Christianity even further and further around. And it is that very, very good soil upon which Qaddus Yared, or Saint Jared, or Holy Jared of Aksum, rose up. He rose up because of the nine saints who it really caused Christianity to flourish, which was given a base by Abba Salama and the willing King Izana, who really helped to spread the Christianity that we have to be thankful for today. Little to nothing is really known about this period, and there's still a lot of research to be done. So if some of you want to be researchers down the line, the church needs you. We're going to be talking about roles quickly towards the end. The church needs you to study this and other periods. So, like I said, we got our stratification or hierarchy, our bishops, priests, and deacons from them, from these people who knew Greek and Syriac. They translated into our language at the time, Giz, right? And they translated for us the Holy Scriptures, the commentaries by that time of a few centuries of fathers who commented on the Holy Scriptures, as well as they brought monasticism or Munkusana to Ethiopia and spread that as well. And then they brought all of the liturgies that we have to this day. And of course, later on, we added that. Then from Yared and others, we add Kolotemirt or Abednet, which is the traditional school in Ethiopia, which I want you to know about. If you don't know, it's where a lot of our fathers have learned, and who knows, hopefully one day maybe I'll get to learn too. But it's a very decentralized local system where when you realize like how thin the string upon which we've been able to survive was, you really understand how much the grace of God has been shed upon us. Because we have people who willingly, who are Abednet Mamran, or teachers of the traditional school, who are willing to take almost no salary. They have their students go who cannot afford to pay them, beg for food as they're getting bitten by dogs, and who are living a very rough lives so that they can stay up all night and study. So they're gathering by day and then studying a little bit by day, studying also by night, barely sleeping night and day to learn the traditional teachings of the Giz, right? Meaning Kadasi, Zema, Kene, and Masayft, or the Eucharistic liturgy, our worship service that has communion, and then all of the hymns that don't have communions that are in the late evenings and early mornings here in America, maybe 5 or 3 a.m. in Ethiopia, every Baal, beginning at 8 p.m. the night before, right? And then we have poetry, or the Kene, which is different, poetry that submits to the Lord, right? That is done also in the church service, that is always created anew. When people try to tell you Giz is a dead language, tell them no, it's a living tongue. It's still alive and well, and people are creating new words and sentences every day unto the glory of God. And finally, Masayft, for those who have studied Kene well enough to know Giz and strength, to have a strong Giz knowledge, they learn the Holy Scriptures and the other books of the sages of our church so that they could defend the church. Now, there's a weird kind of binary or split where we have all of the faithful and we even have priests and deacons and clergy, but really the main knowledge of the church has always kind of been contained in a few elite people who have studied and dedicated themselves to rigorous study so that they could protect and defend the church and spread the knowledge as much as possible. But people of all backgrounds have been able to do that. And as Aksumites, as Gizrite children, all of us have this revealed knowledge through the Greco-Syrians who brought us historic Christianity, through Dusyarid and later Abin Nadhm Mihran, who were able to bring us our traditional schools. God has revealed himself to our people and created a very erudite, scholarly, and literate community, a community dedicated to reading and to writing. So I'm glad that our brother mentioned that. Yeah, I taught myself how to read and write. I always want to never steal credit. Some people try to think that I taught myself Amharic. My parents taught me Amharic. I'll never take credit from them. However, I did teach myself how to read and write. And so others have that. I wasn't by myself. It was because I have this tradition before me of all of these people who are so committed to literacy. What's the thing that makes you most proud about Ethiopia? I hope you don't talk about the Italian and Ethiopian war, because beyond that, especially as Orthodox, it is our dedication to Mas'ahif. It's our dedication to not just reading, but as we did earlier, as Qasis Nehemiah did for us earlier, to read out loud. Most of our people, especially before the Derg, have been illiterate for a long time. And so those few who dedicate themselves to reading, they don't even just read by themselves. They're not greedy or gabgaba with their reading. They read out loud for the community and in community and in the history of an interpretation of the church and of those who came before. We don't reinvent the wheel, but we take the wheel and we adapt that wheel to each ever evolving context. And the wheel for us is the apostolic teaching, which is a family heirloom, which Jesus handed to the apostles, and the apostles handed to the bishops, down to the priests and to the deacons, and to all of us until this very day. I mentioned to you that in the beginning, it's a vast and diverse ocean that we could explore forever. Whether you think Kadasi is going to be your shtick, or you think it's Zema, meaning Mahareta Kwakwa, Dugwa, and everything that resembles it. Whether you think it's going to be Kane or Masaift, every single one of you can find some place to dedicate the rest of your lives to. And especially if we split up the labor amongst us, we'll be able to teach each other forever as teacher and student, brother and sister. And in that way, we will be making ourselves and our ancestors and our future descendants proud to be in this Tawahedo tradition. Because yes, we got the Christianity from the Greco-Syrians, but we also have our own information and treasures from heaven that we would like to share with one another. I want to mention a few Greco-Syrians who are some of my favorite saints. We have, this will be in the trivia later too, so you can figure it out. Marisak, or Isaac the Syrian. Ephrem Soyawi, or Ephrem the Syrian. Johannes Avawerk, or John Chrysostom, the man who was called a mouth of gold. And then, of course, him who I've mentioned already and the church always remembers and was the reason for my last visit to Houston 3 years ago, Kaddus Yared, or St. Jared of Aksum. So while I was reading a commentary or andimta on Tinbita Hizkel or Mesafa Hizkel, the scroll of Ezekiel, one of the major prophets of the Old Testament, in our tradition, I found this beautiful quote that ties all of these traditions together. So we have an officially synodos stamped or synod stamped commentary on the book or the scroll of Ezekiel. It's written in Gittes and Amharic, but inside it has a quote from Marisak, who was a Syrian monk who especially the monks love, but all people can learn from. And he had a very beautiful line in there that I thought would be one way of having a teaching within a teaching, a parable within a parable, or an instruction within instruction for all of you. So I've told you all about the tradition, but so that it doesn't end in a tariq or just a story, I want to give you a practical piece of advice that shows you what treasure we have if we just go out and seek it diligently and eagerly. So Marisak says, Saga yabazal laf nafs, wada sairan dabe, wada chikir na wada makara anji, wada haptat alamawiat, or wada alamawihat at gaba. So the life breath, or the breath of life that abounds in grace, that has grace upon grace put upon it, does not enter into worldly riches. Rather, she enters into tribulation, into troubles, or sufferings. Think about the righteous Job, who is 42 chapters worth of sorrow in the Older Testament that is ultimately used for the glory of God. Whenever we're in Hazen or in sorrow or in sadness, I encourage you to read the 42 chapters of Job. When you see Job, two big things about him. One, he's not even Jewish, and somehow he makes it into the Older Testament. Two, he did almost everything right. Not everything, because no one is good, no, not one. But he did almost everything right, and he still got everything taken away from him. And he said, blessed be the name of the Lord. He said, the Lord giveth and the Lord taketh away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Our Lord Jesus came and did everything right. And from a human perspective, what happened to him? He ended up crucified. So I'll bring it back to the American tradition where we are, where a priest who used to be interested in nuclear disarmament used to say, especially about turning swords into plowshares, he used to say, if you want to follow Jesus, and this is the same thought as Marisak, to show you how the apostolic teaching or the family heirloom is the same. All you need is new examples, illustrations, misalewich, for each student or generation. But Father Daniel Berrigan, an American priest, said, if you want to follow Jesus, you better look good on wood. I'll repeat that so that sits in. If you want to follow Jesus, you better look good on wood. What's about it, Xavier?